read it. It's 1 Thessalonians 5:16 says, "Rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks." I like, you know, we need to be a lot more thankful. Sometimes we're not thankful because something's happened in our life. We get mad about it, we get our feelings hurt, and wonder, where in the world is God? You know, it's like, in that. I want to talk about the pilgrims that came here and founded the colony there at Plymouth, Massachusetts. How did they get here, and why in the world were they thankful after you think about what they went through? I also want to share something with you about them that you might not know. What did some of them give up to go on that trip for religious freedom? There's a little town called Scrooby. It's on the Great North Road north of London. It's at the intersection of Nottingham, York, and Lincoln in England. And there's a little church beginning to grow there as Congregationalists. These are people that were separating away from the Church of England because they didn't agree with some of the Roman Catholic doctrines of the church, because the Church of England, although it was under the king now, or the queen they didn't agree with that doctrine, and so they began separating themselves. One of those people was William Brewster, and they began meeting in his home. His home happened to be the postmaster home, because he was the postmaster at Scrooby. Now, to give you an idea, there were only four postmasters in England. One postmaster, and they all handled the king or queen's mail. That's it. They didn't handle it. You could send a letter through the post office. It was like the post for the king and queen. So he was the postmaster for the road that went to Scotland. There was one other postmaster for Ireland, one for the European continent, and one for the shipyards. That's it. Four of them. He had one of those four positions. Before that, he graduated from Cambridge University at the age of 14. He became assistant to the Secretary of State for Queen Elizabeth. I've never heard this before. I began studying the guy's life, and I said, man, this guy's amazing. When the King of France wanted to have an audition with King James, it was William Brewster who was with Davison, the Secretary of State for King James, who met with them. And Brewster accompanied the Secretary of State to Netherlands, Holland. It's kind of interesting that he made that trip an official visit for the king. He also assisted the Secretary of State in Queen Elizabeth's court, so he had served under at least two different monarchs during his time of service. And then the Pilgrim Fathers began meeting with his separatists in this group in his home. It was his home. Kind of risky to be having a separatist meeting in the home of an official post of the Queen. And I'm going to tell you, Queen Mary had not been executed, we wouldn't have had pilgrims. You know, you wonder sometimes when terrible things happen, how God can be working that together for good. And why in the world is somebody who had such a prosperous career going, and a political career going as well, why would he be willing to give up all of that in order to worship with separatists and suffer with them, and suffer the loss of all that he had, basically? Why would he do that? They got so sick and tired of being persecuted that they finally got on a boat and went over to Holland, the Netherlands, and they stayed there for a while, and then they came back to England and got what they had left, sold what they could, got on the Mayflower, and after two failed attempts, finally they got on the ship and headed toward what is now Massachusetts. First they landed at Cape Cod, then they took some little boats and found the harbor there, Plymouth, Massachusetts, and they moved down there. Here's what got them. They declared the authority of Scripture, not the Pope. That was exactly what got them into a lot of trouble and why they had to escape. And that's why they came. They had had much persecution, including many deaths, imprisonments, and so forth, before they came. So when they set sail, it was a pretty tough journey. They weren't overtaken by pirates, but they had a terrible storm, and during that storm, a big beam in the ship cracked and broke in two, and pilgrims had brought along a large screw, which I think was for a press, because they had been printing in Holland and sending tracts back to England. and kind of activists. And so they had this damage. They used this big screw, this printing press screw, I believe, and they jacked up the beam in the ship and saved the ship. And then they got a lot of seasick. There was one baby born. You mothers can imagine being on this ship. The ceilings were like 5.5 feet high. That's all because it was cargo decks they were in. They were the cargo. And no windows. And so we have these people, and giving birth, this woman had to give birth to a little baby. They named her Oceanus. So that was a little baby. And the sailors were up in the forecastle, the bow. And then the other sailors were on the upper decks. The skipper was in the back. And they were in the cargo hold. That's where they were. 102 men, women, and children arrived at Cape Cod and then down to Plymouth. After 66 days at sea, they finally arrived. And before they established a colony, they understood that they needed to have an agreement. Now, they just happened to have somebody who knew a lot about writing agreements, William Brewster. So his training that he had received at Cambridge and then in the Queen's Court and working with the Secretary of State prepared him to be used of God to write the Mayflower Agreement, which we call the Mayflower Compact. I'll read just a portion of it to you. It says, having under, in the name of God, amen, that's the first part of it, by whose names are underwritten the loyal subjects of our dread sovereign, they call me the dread sovereign, Lord King James, etc., having undertaken for the glory of God and advancement of the Christian faith and honor of our king and country, a voyage to plant the first colony in the northern parts of Virginia. That was, Virginia went all the way from what's now New York, all the way down to the southern part of Virginia at that time, and all the way west to Kentucky, the huge area. And it says, do by these presents solemnly and mutually in the presence of God and one another covenant and combine ourselves together in a civil body politic. Here's what they did. They established that they were here for a Christian purpose. And that agreement became the basis of every constitution in every colony. And every constitution, every colony, and now every constitution, every state in the United States includes God in the wording of the constitution of every state. And the reason was they set an example, and everybody just said, well, how are we going to write our thing? They went and looked at that, and they took from that document and used it as a template or example and began writing their own individual separate constitutions. So the Pilgrims had a tremendous impact upon the future of the United States of America. In fact, John Adams said in 1802, he said their agreement was the only instance in human history of that positive, original social compact, and it had an influence on the Declaration of Independence and the U.S. Constitution. So those didn't have an impact on Christianity. Christianity had an impact on the very structure of our government.
One of the biggest, I would say, negatives, or I don't know if that's the right term. A lot of the young pastors are not able to go through suffering, thus they're not able to appreciate others that are going through suffering. I don't know if that makes sense to you. But like, they get a ministry handed to them, or life is easy, so then when other people are struggling, they're not as apt to have the empathy that they may should have. Suffering grows you. Let me put it that way. Suffering helps you to become what you need to be. Trials make you stronger as a Christian. Jesus doesn't take our burdens away. He helps us to bear the burdens that we have.
Amen.
And he grows us through this life that we live. And anyway, we were just talking about that. That a lot of the young pastors that I see, it's like they haven't hurt enough to understand what it's like to hurt. And I guess one of the blessings of starting a church is that you get to hurt a little bit. Anyway, if you have your Bible, turn to Psalms chapter 100. And I'm going to just read you this short scripture here and just give you some thoughts about things that we could be thankful for. I've got it typed on my phone, and my phone is at 6%, so I gotta give it to you before it dies, alright? Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. I love that right there. I want to just give you a quick thought on things that we could be thankful for, and I'd like to just read them to you. First of all, I'd like to encourage you to be thankful for the Bible that we have. I wrote scriptures with the Bible, the same thing. Be thankful for the Bible that we have. I'm thankful today that I live in a country where I am free to have the Word of God. And most of you, if you're like me, you don't not only have one Bible, but you have multiple Bibles in your house. Amen. I've got two or three Bibles in my office. No, I've got more than that. I've got a lot of Bibles in my office. I've got Bibles in my house. I've got a Bible in my car. April's got a Bible in her van that we keep so that we're able to use it whenever it's necessary. And I'm thankful that I have a Bible. How about you two? Are you thankful for that? And something else that I think that we would encourage you to be thankful for. I'm thankful for my church family. How about you? I'm thankful for my church family. You know, we live in the world that we live in can be tough. I mean, there can be trials. I mean, you ever get stuck in traffic? Anybody ever get stuck in traffic? Did anybody see the video of people leaving LA in the last couple days and the traffic, right? We have some truck drivers here. You live in traffic, all right? God has given you an extra measure of mercy and strength. And anyway, but if you ever get stuck in traffic, you know, it doesn't seem like the nicest place in the world. You know, people are looking at each other, they're mad at each other, being hand gestures at each other, and it's not a good thing, you know? But anyway, you know, the world can be rough that you live in. You can go to the gas station and there's bad things happening. You go to the Walmart, there's things that are, it's like, what is this happening? You go, everywhere you go, there's trials, there's conflict, there's heartache, there's brokenness, there's bitterness, all this kind of stuff going on in the world. But then you come to church, it's like, oh, it's a good place. And I'm thankful for my church family. I hope that you are too. I want to be thankful for not only my church family, but the fellowship that we have. I've seen churches that did not have the proper fellowship. It was almost there that they came to church out of duty. And I don't know if you know what I mean by that. And it was a discipline. Why do you go to church? Because I've always gone to church. Why do you go to church? Because my mom took me to church. Why do you go to church? Because my grandma went to church. And my great-grandma went to church. And so I go to church. And it's almost like I go to church because I have to. Now, duty would be the lowest form of requirement. Now, I would hope that you would have something that would encourage you to go to church more than what you have to do. But if that's where you're at, I'll take it. But I would love for you to go to church because, man, there's people here that I like to see. You know? Now, that's not my purpose of church. That's not the only reason I go to church. I come to church for the Bible. I come to church so I can have people to pray with. I come to church so I can have a place to give to the work of God. I come to church to hear some singing. I come to church so I can praise God and sing. There's a lot of reasons I go to church, but one of those reasons is I get to fellowship. I enjoy being able to fellowship with other like-minded Christians about the things of God. What else can we be thankful for? We can be thankful for our children, can't we? Some days. I'm thankful for my children, and I know that you are. My children are just like yours. They're not perfect by a long shot. Most of you know them. They've been in your classes, and you've gone to church with them for years now. You know they're not perfect, but they're my children. I love them, and I thank God for them. I hope that you, if you have children, be thankful for the ones that God gave you. Amen?
Amen.
By the way, if you discipline children, you normally like your children because they're easy to be around, and you be thankful for children. Most people that I've seen who don't like children are ones that don't take care of discipline and teach them the right. Anyway, that's another sermon. All right, cool. Let's be thankful for our children. Now, this one's interesting. We ought to be thankful for our finances. Now, I would probably guess that most of you would be like me And he would say, Lord, if you'd bless me with a lot more, I could be a lot more thankful. How about you? You know, there's never enough. But when April and I, when we came to California, we had some days where we had nothing. And I don't know how to describe that. And what I mean by that is, we had nothing. We prayed. One day, we literally got on our knees and prayed, God, would you help? We need food. Would you take care of us? While we were praying, you can ask my wife, while we were praying, someone knocked on our door from our church. We didn't tell everybody, oh, we need this. You know, some people pray for us. Or, would you pray with us? We need $150, okay? You know, anyway, it wasn't like that. We needed food. And I always take care of my family, you know, do whatever you gotta do, work hard and all that. Someone knocked on our door and delivered to us and gave us what we needed. I can tell you their names, I can tell you their. It was Susie and Marshall. If you know who they are, if you don't know where they're at, you know Marshall and Susie, don't you? Do you? I think you would. But they knocked on our door, brought us, we hugged them, brought them in the house. They're like, well, the Lord just laid you on our heart. We're like, oh, this is so good. And we were allowed, going through that trial, allowed God, allowed us to see God work in our lives. And we are thankful. Now I'm thankful we got food now. Look at me, okay, we got food. But I'm thankful that we went through trials in our life because it helped us to become who God wanted us to be. Lord, I pray that our nation, America, would return back to you. That we would understand that we are truly blessed by God and that you have full ownership of us and we are not self-made and we are not self-righteous. In all of our flaws and all of our weaknesses, we know that we have a great God who repairs, who heals, who strengthens, who endures, and who really is truly merciful to us. God, I pray that you would be with this, our nation. I pray that you would be with this church in its entirety. I pray that your blessings would be upon each and every person. I pray that you would keep us safe. I pray that you would bless our Thanksgiving season. I pray, Lord, that we would honor and glorify you. We love you, Lord. We ask in Jesus' name, amen.